we'll look at the how, what, how we validated WEMWBS, how we developed and validated it. And we started off with an instrument called the Affectometer 2. Now, this came out of New Zealand in the 1970s. It was way ahead of its time. I discovered it when I was pondering, you know, what we do about mental well-being and how we measure it and, you know, where. And I was kind of looking around for these instruments, and I came across this one, and I get a look at it, and I think, that's the sort of thing, that'd do. And I show it to a few colleagues around the place, and they go, yeah, that's the sort of thing, that'd do. In Scotland, NHS Health Scotland, they managed to find some funding to help us validate WEMWBS in 2000, and also in the UK. So we undertook quite a significant validation of the Affectometer in the UK, both in Edinburgh and in Warwick, and both quantitatively and using focus groups. And we worked with an expert panel, and we worked with the result of those surveys. And the expert panel were drawn from people who were very well aware of all the research into mental health and well-being in its various guises, like eudaimonic well-being, or psychological well-being, or hedonic well-being, and subjective well-being, and all these different terms. The results of the Affectometer study showed that it was longer than it needed to be. It was 14-odd items, and that the self-deception bias seemed to be coming out with that was higher than we would have liked. So given the idea it was too long, and we short instruments are always more useful because people can complete them more quickly. We worked with the focus, with the expert panel, and we came out with the Warwick Edinburgh Mental Wellbeing Scale, which is a new scale. It differed from the Affectometer in that it only had positive items, and there are very few instruments around where all the items are positively phrased and they're all about positive concepts. And that's the main, that is the main area that WEMWBS differs from the other instruments. So it invites people to focus on what they can do and what's okay in their lives rather than the opposite. It covers both the psychological well-being and subjective well-being. It's self-complete, it's got a two-week scale of reference, and it's a five-point Likert scale, and that's what it looks like. And many of you will know it well because you will have used it. And for those of you who can't see from the back, that's what the items actually say. So we, having done the validation with the Affectometer, then developed WEMWBS, we then need to go into a validation of WEMWBS. And this is what we did. We used a sample of students, which is a convenient sample. They were both undergraduate and graduate, so quite an age spectrum, and both in Scotland and in England. With this student sample, we could choose what other instruments we put in and what the questionnaire looked like. So we had eight other scales that we could validate it against. And we could put the social desirability scales in, which gave us some idea of how much bias there was in the completion of them. And we were able to go back to them and do a test-retest reliability. But we also had another sample, because WEMWBS had been put into the HEPS, the Health Education Population Survey in Scotland, and the WELL surveys. So we had data on 2000 and over 2000 16 to 74 year olds. And in these surveys, they'd also completed the general health questionnaire. And that sample then could give us some population norms, which you can't get out of student surveys. So now we've got to do some little bit of serious work with numbers, and it's all right, don't get in a panic. You don't have to understand everything that goes, but I'll just take you a little bit through what you do with a quantitative evaluation of instruments. First of all, you look to see whether, you know, some of the response categories simply aren't being used, and that wasn't true. People did check every single one of those Likert scale responses to each items, and there weren't any obvious floor or ceiling effects, so people were mostly scoring round about the middle, and there was some at either end. When we did our confirmatory factor analysis, we came up with a one-factor solution. Now, that means, the terms of psychometricians and people who look at instruments, that mental well-being is a single underlying construct, and this instrument is tapping into that single underlying construct and picking up on it. Now, it just occurred to me in looking at this, of course, that's in direct contradistinction to the possibility of a dual continuum model or anything more. And I think it's simplistic. I don't think, we'll come on to this in a minute, but I don't think mental well-being probably is a single underlying construct. However, if you want a measure that people will take seriously in the literature and you want to be able to add it up, the items, and get a single score, you do need one of these. And you do need a single factor solution. So WEMWBS, God bless it, just did the biz and came in with capturing enough of what we need to know in a way that's sound enough for people to take seriously. The Cronbach alpha, which is about internal consistency, is a very high coefficient that you're looking for somewhere around about 7.58. And it suggests, again, we've got slightly more items than we need in this, but it's very sound. So we'll come back to that. If we now look at the correlation coefficients with all these different scales we put in, they're working pretty much as you'd expect. If we look at the two life satisfaction scales, the global one works slightly better than the specific one. And it was correlated with emotional intelligence, but not at such a high level as everything else. If you look at the positive and negative affect scales, which were strong competitors, slightly strong, long, it correlates much better negatively with the negative one, but positively and more strongly with the positive affect scale. The one it correlated best with is the WHO5, and I think that's quite an interesting measure that we might want to do some more work on it, because it's a very simple, positively worded instrument that covers physical health more. Much more than WEMWBS. It's got sort of attributes of energy and I can't remember all of them, but it has more of a flavour of physical as well as mental health, that scale. And the EQ5 thermometer. And of course, in the population survey, we had the correlation with the GHQ5, and that was what we got. So it is correlated negatively, as you'd expect, but they also are reasonably different. If we look at this balanced inventory of desirable responding, this gives you two scales. I might actually try and do it like this. No, yes, there we are. Impression management, does it look like you're filling in the scale to look like you ought to? You know, people want you to look. And are you deceiving yourself? WEMWBS did better on the impression management than the affectometer had and than many other scales that are around at the moment. Yeah, okay, got to do this. Particularly WHO5, which does seem to have more of an issue there. Some of these come in lower, but then if you look at the self-deception, WEMWBS also does pretty well against some of these other scales, and you want a balance between those two. So it's not looking bad. This is an issue with any mental health scale. You know, it takes a certain level of self-awareness to know what your mental health is, and a lot of our population do not have it. And so they're not going to be scoring spot on. People do want to give a good impression of themselves, and they do fool themselves, and this comes through in all instrument validation. It's not the end of the world. I mean, there is not an epidemiological measure that is not subject to some of this noise, and what you're doing is looking for a measure that's good enough for purpose. It won't be perfect. The test-retest reliability was fine. You don't expect it to be 100% correlation, because people do change over the course of a couple of weeks. We did use WEMWBS in one big study that went on in England. It was just measuring before and measuring after. There was no control. But this was the Parenting Early Intervention Pathfinder in England, where a great many parents went through parenting programs that were provided by the local authorities and schools. And we got a really quite big effect size change between before and after the program. So that suggested that this WEMWBS is sensitive to change. So from that we get WEMWBS is a valid and reliable instrument. It does the bits from a psychometric point of view. It's valid in population surveys, and it's very likely to be sensitive to change. We have been advising people that if they've got less than 100 in their sample, they can't be sure they're going to pick up change simply because of statistical power, nothing to do with the instrument. But as more and more surveys and evaluations come in, we'll have a better idea of what sort of numbers it does work for.